inspirational about the work you all do in the community. And of course, the Governor's Prevention Partnership, Jill and her whole team for putting this together. I've worked with many of you for a long time. Can you all hear me okay with the microphone? Great. John Davio and prevention, the prevention folks here all across the state, many of you are members of our SAM group. We were here a couple of years ago talking about this issue, and we worked with you, with Yale and others. So it's really a pleasure to be in front of you today talking about this issue, which I think, you know, it seems controversial because it's one of those issues that a lot of people like to bring their own perspective to it, and they sort of generalize, and I think that's one of the difficulties with it, because it's hard to stick to the science when people are saying, well, yeah, I get that that's what the science said, but, you know, I remember this person, and this happened to me, and we were fine, or whatever, and people are often transferring their own experiences and not really talking about the science. It's also an interesting topic because, you know, unlike a drug like heroin that produces, you know, can produce fatal overdose from the immediate episode of using the drug, marijuana often, I sort of call it the slow kill. I actually call it the dropout drug in more than the deadly drug. It's the dropout drug in a way that not only dropping out of school, which is a huge part of it, and sort of that's why it's so fitting that we're here at a college, but really, and if you know people who use pot all the time, we're talking about dropping out of life, dropping out of school, of family obligations, work obligations, community obligations. And we really have to think about if we want to promote, especially at a time when, you know, the state of Connecticut is trying to actually be competitive on an educational and a workplace point of view, if we want to promote a drug that I call the dropout drug. It doesn't mean everybody drops out when they use. And we do know that not everyone who uses marijuana is going to have a negative consequence. So I'm not here also saying that either. We also, by the way, know that not every daily smoker is going to get lung cancer, right? That's not a reason we should promote smoking. We know that not everyone, frankly, who drives drunk is going to get into a fatal car crash. Not a reason to promote drunk driving. But we do know when you do drive drunk and when you do smoke daily, your chances for negative outcomes increase exponentially. And that's the issue here with marijuana. There will be plenty of people who will use it and not have a problem. But the point is, when you start increasing, promoting, commercializing its use, and its heavy use, I'm going to argue today, not just occasional use, then I think you have a problem. I'm not sure if I'm turning this on correctly, because I'm sort of straining. I'm not sure if it's actually on, so yeah, no, it's not. Let's try that. I think that might be, well, it's on now, but you can check with the audio people to see. I think now it's on. Okay, yeah, I was noticing. And so that's what I think we're talking about today, is something that's often really misunderstood. I want to also just mention that a lot of what we're saying, and it's true, Jill talked about how we could be here all day. I talk about a lot of this in my book, Reefer Sanity, Seven Great Myths About Marijuana. The second edition's coming out, I think, later this summer, I hope. And really, I wrote this book at a time in 2011, 2012, as I was leaving the Obama administration, as I was noticing that we were really going down this dangerous path as a country on this issue. And we were really being stuck on what I would call as a false dichotomy of you can either lock people up in prison and give them an arrest record for using marijuana, or you could legalize the drug, as if there was no other thing that you could do. You know, I think when it's presented like that, that's not a winner, really, for anybody. They both represent extremes. Frankly, I've never met a member of law enforcement that wants to be locking people up in prison for using marijuana. I mean, that's not something that even law enforcement wants to do. But there is a myth that that's out there, and so people think that, well, if we're not going to lock people up, I guess we have to legalize. And I really do think that that is a false dichotomy. So we started SAM as a result of when I left in 2011 and feeling like we got to do something as a country more comprehensive. I felt that, you know, there's always been a bipartisan consensus against drugs in this country. It's never been a partisan issue, but I sort of saw the writing on the wall politically and from a party point of view, and I thought we need to wrestle this away from the sort of emotional partisan discussion to have a more of a scientific discussion and more of a data-driven discussion and experience-driven discussion. So I said, I'm gonna go actually, to make it apolitical, I'm gonna go find the most political people I could find on the opposite sides of the spectrum, sort of cancel it all out, I guess you could say. So on the left, it was very easy who that person was going to be. Congressman Patrick Kennedy, Obviously, his brother has ties here in Connecticut, is a member of the state legislature. Was somebody who was outspoken in recovery, and many of you have seen his recent book, A Common Struggle, and I mean, he's, you know, within his own family, still being vilified, actually, for talking about these issues so openly. And I felt that he was very courageous to talk about these things, given how public, you know, they can't breathe without it still being, you know, making headline news. You can imagine the scrutiny and the pressure that puts on people. And, you know, Patrick was one of the very few in Congress who actually stepped up and got Congress to agree to something that you're gonna find is so fascinating when I tell you what they finally agreed to. And that was, Congress agreed to the fact that the brain is actually part of the body. And I mean that, because we always treated mental health and physical health different, right? Knee problems, sprained ankle, tennis elbow, whatever, you were gonna get treated from a medical point of view. But if you had something going on up here, mental illness, addiction, et cetera, we didn't know how to deal with it. You know, we said, well, we're gonna put you in a, you know, place far away. You know, about 30 years ago we said that, right? We're gonna put you in a place far away with other people like you and just hope that it goes away because we don't really wanna see it, right? Then we said, that's expensive, that's too expensive. So we're gonna release you and just kind of hope for the best. Then we said, gosh, that's causing a lot of problems. What we'll do is cover you so about an hour a month you can see someone, get it off your chest, and then they'll just write you a nice little prescription and you'll be done. And that's how we treated these issues for so long. And George Bush does not get credit enough for this, I think, actually. And this is, you know, I worked for both the Obama and the Clinton administration. But actually, George Bush's last bill in office, which was not signed with much fanfare, but Patrick was right behind him, was the Mental Health Addiction Parity Act, which mandated insurance companies to actually treat these the same. Now, of course, there's still a huge struggle of implementing that because, obviously, people who's it's not in their financial interest are going to find ways around it. But the point was, he was very courageous on that issue. So then I said, I got to find a really conservative person. And Dick Cheney, unfortunately, wouldn't return my phone calls. So he was busy. He was a little busy. So you remember, he got into some things in 2011, 2012, yeah. So couldn't do that. But David Frum was actually the speechwriter for George Bush at the time, conservative intellectual, was writing about this issue. And so we got David and Patrick to agree on something, which was a miracle, and they agreed that we did not want to go down this path of mass commercialization and promotion of this drug. Because, friends, let's make no mistake about it, this is not about regulation. This is not about taxation and control. This is not even about a criminal justice reform, which I'm in favor of, and we'll talk about it in a little bit, and we're going to talk about later today. This is about one thing and one thing only, and that's money. This is about a small number of people getting rich and, frankly, seeing how the tobacco industries, the pharmaceutical industries, and the alcohol industries, frankly, gambling and other industries as well, have gotten rich off of people's addictions. Because if this was about getting people out of prison, well, why don't we stop it in criminalization? No one has ever been able to answer that question for me, the legalization lobby. If this was about, you know, the medical applications of certain components, well, I have a novel idea that is genius and that I came up with this. I think medicine should be dispensed at a pharmacy and prescribed by a doctor. Isn't that crazy? Totally crazy, right? So why don't we do those rational things as opposed to this idea of really mass commercialization? So we started SAM, and I'm not going to go into great detail about it, but we then partnered with almost every major medical association in this country. And when I approached the medical community folks, they, you know, God bless them, they were saying, well, we've already talked about that, Kevin. You mean every American hasn't read the 375-page, you know, report that we wrote about marijuana and its problems? You mean that, you know, the average American doesn't have on their nightstand before they go to bed some light reading from Lancet Psychiatry that they like to read about? And so the point was, scientists who are doing the great work, and there are many here today, revealing what's going on with today's marijuana, that is not being translated into language that people can understand. Instead, when a 16-year-old Googles marijuana, they don't see Lancet Psychiatry. They don't see the Journal of the American, or maybe they see, they don't read them, that's for sure, the Journal of the American Medical Association with all of its findings. The WHO report, World Health Organization, UN, that just came out 2 weeks ago from 4 dozen researchers from around the world that reviewed that document, outlining the harms and cautioning the entire world from going down this path.
But what they do see are 37,000 hits on YouTube from the guys that are, many of them who are, by the way, paid by the industry. This isn't just like random people who are these YouTube stars. They are put there and paid by the industry to look homemade, that teach you how to make 98% THC butane hash oil, that teach you how to use vaporization devices, e-cigarettes, in public view at schools, and so that people, because people can't see what they're doing. And there is this massive propaganda machine by the industry saying, it's not only harmful, it's good for you. And so we're losing in that way, because that has really gone out there in this sort of very, very big way. So we said to the medical community and the law enforcement prevention, other groups, we want to take what you're doing and kind of harness it into a national movement. So we really think that legalization is nothing less than really this picture. And there's no other way to sort of put it in a more concise way. This is about the mass commercialization and promotion of this drug. Folks, the addictive industries in this country, they don't make money from occasional users. Right? They don't. The alcohol industry does not make money from the person who has a glass of wine with dinner. Okay? You don't make money from the person who has two beers watching a game on a Sunday. You do make money, though, from the small number of people who use your product almost every day in an extremely dangerous, irresponsible way. The same thing's with gambling. Think about it. Last time you've been to a hotel casino, who got the upgrade to the penthouse suite? Was it the person who they didn't, you know who they were because they come there once a year and play $50 blackjack at the most? Or was it the person that they know first name, last, and every social security number and everything else because they're there on a regular basis withdrawing $500 from the ATM machine playing the tables? Well, obviously that person, because you want to promote that kind of behavior if you're in this business. It's the only way you make money. And so, you know, I know there are well-meaning people, and there are, who are, this is not about money for them, just from a policy point of view, you say, well, maybe we could regulate it in a certain way, control and tax and do something that could be, you know, it's here to stay, Kevin. We're not, drug-free society is you know, tilting at windmills. That's never going to happen. So, by the way, you know, we have a goals, when you say drug-free society, we have goals for a cancer-free society, an AIDS-free society, a homeless-free society was the point of the war on poverty that was launched in the 1960s. Now, because not every single person, you know, is not homeless, well, that doesn't mean that, therefore, your goal, everything is a failure and you need to go to the other side of it. No, you have lofty goals. I mean, can you imagine if every little kid who said they wanted to be president of the United States, you told them, actually, you know, your chances are about one in something, probably with immigration, everything like that, 250 million or something. Totally, you know, don't dream to do that. Dream, you know, to be the assistant manager at rent a car here at the airport, because that you might exceed that. I don't know. But let's start with, we would never say that. Of course you dream big. Your goal is something big. So we're being ridiculed for saying we want a drug-free society. Well, that is a goal. The goal that we want a racism-free society, a poverty-free society, et cetera, et cetera. You want to aim for that. And so with this issue, we're actually being told it's here around it as if we can do that. And that's the big myth of regulation. There's no regulation. Has anybody been to Colorado lately? Show me the regulation and the fact that there are now 25 marijuana stores within 1,000 feet of schools, even though that's supposed to be illegal. Show me the regulation when billboards are supposed to be illegal and yet they're popping up everywhere. Show me the regulation in which things are not supposed to be aimed at kids, and yet the last time I checked, the average 50-year-old guy did not want to be having gummy bears, sour pops, and, you know, THC, you know, laden things with Flintstones and Sesame Street characters. Okay? So, and that, those are real. That's happening. So the point is, you know, how do we do this and how do we create policy in a way that's helpful? And Newsweek put it very, big tobacco, by the way, is bad. They're back not only in the forms of the e-cigarette issue, they're, that is also connected with marijuana, but they're also back, in my mind, in the form of marijuana. This is a massive industry with special interests in every state capital in the country, with special interests in Washington, D.C., which is where Sam is based, take my word for it, that are there pounding the pavement with their legislators, promising everything from to the legislators from, you know, you'll be more popular because 60% of the people in our poll said that they were in favor of marijuana, so you want to be in favor of it too. That's actually compelling for a legislator. Or they dangle money in front of the legislator and say, ah, we'll tax it and you'll have some money to spend on the things you want to spend on. You know, we'll spend on education and all those great things. Now, of course, by the way, I mean, you have a lottery here?
Yes.
So schools number one in the country, solve that issue of education?
No.
Well, that's the point, right? This is the false promise. Do you know why alcohol prohibition was repealed, by the way? I'm going off script. This is just interesting. You should read a book called Last Call by Daniel Okrent. The Ken Burns documentary was based on that prohibition. Because people think, well, it was a massive failure. Well, I don't know. It just depends on the stats. Actually, alcohol use did go down. But it's hard to prohibit something 70% of people use. I mean, that's different, by the way, than marijuana. That's why I think it's apples and oranges when you do industrialists. And it was the 10 people that were sort of building this country. Those are the people that had the power for the where the president and Congress was concerned. They were in favor of prohibition in the beginning because they were worried about their workforce. They changed when they were promised we would never have a corporate or individual income tax anymore because we could use all that tax revenue from alcohol. And so that is the reason that the famous industrialists switched on prohibition and said, you know what, actually we do want to see a repeal. It's this promise of tax revenue that we're not seeing, and we're going to talk about that later today as well. I'm very concerned about the increase, dramatic increase of marijuana use in the last 10 to 15 years. The yellow is marijuana here, the red is alcohol, binge drinking. And this is daily marijuana use. So I really could care less if you are the, 60-year-old who wants to smoke a joint in your house once a month or something. As long as you're not going to get in a car or be my pilot or doctor or something, which I definitely would not want you to be using occasionally, but whatever. If you're retired early and all that, this is not about the occasional person who wants to smoke marijuana here and there, okay? Now, I don't think that's good for you, but that's not what this whole issue is about. This issue, as I was saying before, is about heavy use. And in this country over the last 20 years, the number of people using marijuana almost every day. So, unless you're living, under a rock, you are affecting other people by using marijuana on a heavy basis like that every day. This is what worries me. And since 1992, we've had an almost 800% increase in daily or near daily marijuana use. By the way, we've also had an increase in binge drinking, so don't think that there's this myth of substitution, like people are going to choose one or the other. They're totally different. Why would you choose one or the other? And they're not choosing one or the other, by the way. Young people are using them both. And so are the average American. So binge drinking has increased dramatically, as marijuana has, but the ratio from binge drinking to daily marijuana use used to be 10 to 1 gap. Actually, even though they're both going up, it's now a 2 to 1 gap, just because of how big the increase in daily marijuana use has been. And, I think that is problematic when we think about our workplaces, when we think about schools, when we think about our roads, when we think about people that take kids, et cetera, et cetera. This is, I think, very, very problematic. But why is it problematic? And this is the issue people say, well, what's the big deal? It's safer than alcohol. Frankly, cigarette smoking kills 500,000 people a year, Kevin, that's legal. Why do we really need to care about marijuana? And these are, by the way, the 7 myths that we're not going to go through all of them today, but this issue of marijuana being harmless and non-addictive, we are going to go through that. We have other people here to talk about that, so I'm going to very much speed through this. But in my mind, this is problematic because for young people because your brain is under constant development until about age 30, actually. And so the issue is your brain is under construction, folks. Just like your house when it's under construction, if there's an earthquake when it's under construction, that's probably a bigger problem than when it's an earthquake 50 years after it's been built. That's how to understand the brain. And so anything to get in contact with the brain, good or bad, can affect that brain the most when it's growing. You learn a third language or second language when you're 5 years old, it's a lot easier than when you're 50. You learn to swim. Can you imagine if we waited to learn to swim? If your parents said, we're worried about our 4-year-old, so we're going to wait till they're 40. Because then they'll be smarter and then they won't drown. Kind of make it kids shouldn't be. No. How much longer is that? You don't do that. So the point is your brain picks things up easier when it's younger. Bottom line. And therefore the double-edged sword on that is that that drugs can, and abuse and bad memories, all that as well, can essentially hijack the brain in a much more profound way than if it was an adult brain. And today's marijuana is affecting certain parts of the brain. Remember, marijuana is 500 or more components. It's a very complex plant. One of those components is called THC. That's what affects the brain, what binds the receptors in these areas of the brain, vision, coordination, sensation, movement, reward, and memory, by the way. And this is where addiction occurs. And there's a lot of myths out there about addiction, right? People think that marijuana is not addictive. Have you heard the term physical versus psychological addiction, right? Those make no sense. There's no, addiction is addiction. You might have symptoms that are physical and psychological, but it's the same thing. Your reward and memory part of your brain, you remembered something you did that you liked and you want to do it again. That's it. Regardless of the consequences, sometimes. And so, you know, when I have young people raise their hand in a presentation, they'll say, Kevin, I know marijuana is not addictive. Really? Why do you know that? Sophomore in high school. Well, I know that because not only did I read it on the internet, and you know, everything you're saying is propaganda, because from what I read on the internet, it's really, that's where it is. And the other reason I know about it, Kevin, is because I use marijuana every day. That's why I know that it's not addictive. That's seriously what someone said to me recently with a straight face. You know, the other thing they said is, Kevin, marijuana is natural, right? They said, I was in Utah, very religious state. They said, Kevin, are you anti-God? This is a 14-year-old. Are you anti-God because it comes from God? Marijuana is natural. It comes from God. And I said, well, I'm not anti-God, but you know what else comes from God that I wouldn't want to smoke? Poison ivy. That's also natural. Hemlock is natural. I don't want to get near that. Uranium, nothing. I want nothing to do with it. There are a lot of things I want nothing to do with. Who cares if it's natural? And by the way, it's not natural because we have genetically altered marijuana. We have bred it in a certain way that increases the THC and actually takes out the other things that actually might have some medical value that we're learning about. That's the irony, is that the average marijuana that a kid is smoking has no, have you heard of cannabidiol, CBD? We've had a debate, I know, in the state about that. Cannabidiol, which does not act on the brain in the same way, it has no CBD in it, the average marijuana. But again, kids are being fed, we're mixing all these issues up. And so the average 15-year-old thinks it's not addictive, it's medicine, how can it be bad for you? And there's all this propaganda that the U.S. government is funding to tell us that it's bad. And they're not understanding, oh, and all of our prisons are full because of marijuana users. That's it. And they're not understanding the reality of where this is. And this is the bottom line, is the THC, the psychoactive ingredient, what gets you high, has increased greatly in this country. And, you know, we've basically become better farmers at this point. And that's why, so when my parents' generation of baby boomers are like, well, we used it 20, 30 years ago, and it wasn't a big deal, and we're fine. They used a different drug, friends. They did not use the marijuana of today, which is completely different. They certainly didn't know what this was. 98% potent THC. And this is what you'll find, tens of thousands of videos on YouTube teaching you how to do it. PVC pipe, butane, resin in the pipe, and all of a sudden you have, you know, drip, drip, drop, the honey, they call it like honey oil, it sort of feels like honey in that way, coming out, which is pure, almost pure THC. Folks, this isn't a plant. This isn't marijuana anymore. Marijuana means the hundreds of components that comprise that cannabis plant. This has nothing to do with marijuana. This is only the THC. It's only one molecule of those hundreds. And this is what gets you high. And so as your brain, by the way, you know, gets used to using marijuana, you need this to feel anything, right? You need this. And you know, we're not going to get into this today because we don't have the time. But you know, how can we talk about an opiate and heroin crisis and totally ignore the elephant in the room, which is marijuana, which is often, I'm not going to say gateway. I don't really like that word. It sort of lost its meaning. Brings out, you know, sort of shouting matches. But I use the word pathway in many ways, because for many people, it is a pathway. It may not be the thing that opens the gate to them using heroin. The majority of marijuana users will not use heroin, but I will tell you, 98% of heroin users did use marijuana beforehand. And we're learning a lot more about the brain and its need for bigger highs, and the fact that in the cannabinoid and opiate receptors in the brain, that there are connections we didn't even know about before. So this is a to be continued, we need to learn more about it. But the idea that when I see politicians and others railing against heroin and then, you know, on the other side of their mouth saying maybe we should legalize marijuana, it makes absolutely no sense at all. That's why, you know, we've been seeing this increase in emergency room admissions for panic attacks in this country for marijuana. We didn't see that in the 1960s. You might have had a few. We didn't see hundreds of thousands of panic. I mean, all of Woodstock would have had a panic attack. We would have had a million people in the hospital there in New York. You didn't see that as much. You see it now because of today's THC-laden marijuana. And you also see a lot of other things. When you look at studies over time, thousands of people, when you aggregate those studies, you see high school completion, university entrance scores, all of these things of IQ being affected by the regular use of marijuana. And, you know, I always have people say, well, but I know a really smart person and they get straight A's and they use marijuana all the time.
Well, that's great. I know a lot of people who don't bite with helmets and they don't get brain injuries. So what? It's not smart to do it. But yes, there will be people that do that, that well. And then I have other people say, well, if they could only choose marijuana instead of alcohol, it would be better for young people. And folks, that is like telling a young person, if only you jumped out of the fourth floor window rather than the eighth floor, you would be safer. You don't want them to jump out of any floor. That's a false choice that we're giving to young people about this. And it's certainly something that's not going to be helping them in the future at all, especially when you look at the studies on IQ. And, you know, 8-point IQ loss, which is what this study said. If you're Steve Jobs and, you know, you're a genius, 150 IQ, you know, you can lose 8 points and you'll probably be okay.
Right.
But if you're the average student in this state, 100 IQ, and you lose 8 points, that makes a big difference. That makes a very big difference. And already, if either because of the neighborhood you come from or the color of your skin, it's hard enough for you to get a job, and you already have enough things going against you, the idea that this dropout drug, this drug that checks you out of life, many people, if you use it enough, is going to be helping those who already have a hard enough time going to a school that has textbooks from this century, then we have to see about what that impact is going to be. And let me tell you, it's kind of embarrassing. I go to international conferences, the UN. I do a lot of work with the UN. And I go to these conferences, and I always have, like, China, India, Singapore, South Korea. Lately, they've been coming up to me, like, Kevin, let us get this straight. You're debating legalizing marijuana because you all think this is going to be good for your economy and your workplace? You think this is going to be good for the global, you know, you're railing against how other countries are stealing your jobs, and you're saying that you're going to be okay with this drug that affects people, you know, and it's sort of like, oh, well, it's not me. I mean, I don't know what to say. I'm tongue-tied. And, of course, I'm saying, well, I'm trying to change the subject. Well, what are you all debating in your country? Well, we're debating whether or not the dropout rate, you know, should be 0.5% or 0.3%. There's a lot of controversy. You know, we're debating whether we should increase teacher salary because it's the most revered job in our country by 50% or 55.5%. There's a big controversy which one we should do. That's what we're debating, Kevin. I mean, it's incredible to see the window, by the way, just from a global perspective of when you talk about a competitive marketplace in the world, how this is affecting the discourse on this issue. University degree, unemployment, suicide attempts, other drug use, on and on and on. The bottom line is the more you use, not the person that used once, we're not saying that, but the more you use, it is a relationship with these negative consequences when you look over time and when you control for other things as well. And this is, by the way, our education, you know, we rank 36th math, 28th science, 24th reading, and those are generous rankings, I think, for us, out of about between 40 and 60 countries. And yet we rank close to number one in the world for young people using marijuana. I just don't know how that's helping us as a country. I don't know how that's going to help us as a state. Mental illness is a huge part of this too, and I don't want to dwell on it, but the issue of mental illness, you cannot be in favor of mental health and be okay with this singular drug, more than any of the other illegals, by the way, that are connected with psychosis and schizophrenia. You can't. Because of the way that regular use and what the research is showing on mental illness. And those of you who, I mean, I'm sure many of you work with people that have mental illness and have the co-occurring, and we don't know often which comes first. I get that question a lot. But Kevin, I think it's the mental illness that came first, and that's why they use marijuana, because it made them feel better. Or is it the other way? You know, it actually doesn't matter which way it is. The bottom line is it makes it worse. Whether it was because of this, we're all, healing condition is varied and diverse. It's probably half and half. I mean, who knows whether somebody who is first or second, chicken before the egg. The bottom line is that's an academic debate. The point is it makes it worse, especially when you look at high potency. And then the driving issue. You know, the amount of misperception on driving. I have other young people who have told me before, Kevin, I drive safer when I'm high versus, you know, when I'm not high, they're saying. And I said, well, why do you think you drive safer? You know, to ask the question, why do you think you drive safer when you're high? Well, I go 35 miles an hour in a 65 mile per hour zone. So I'm much safer. That's not safe, by the way. That's about like driving 85. if you compare the risk. And think about the people who you know who are using marijuana a lot. Tell me about their reaction time and reflexes. That's the number one thing you need when you drive. Your brain is doing like 5,000 things a second when you drive. I mean, it's fascinating. I mean, you're like seeing what's going on here, you're listening, you're thinking about where you're going in the future, you're thinking about what you just did, you're looking right in front of you, you're looking behind. The amount of things that you're doing you don't even realize. Well, it's obvious that a drug that essentially slows you down in many ways is going to affect your driving. And we just got the report out of AAA. It was even too new to include in the recent this PowerPoint, which came out 2 days ago from Washington State, showing a huge spike, as many of you saw, in fatal car crashes from people who were high. Now, there's this whole argument. They weren't high, Kevin. It was in their system because they happened to use marijuana 29 days ago, and then but they didn't use at all after that, and then they tested, and then they were positive for marijuana. No. There are ways, even though it's very difficult, but if it's high enough in the blood and concentration, and they're also driving erratically, well, you can, and they have no other drugs in their system, you can kind of, you know, make an educated guess there about what's going on, about why they didn't stop at the stop sign, you know, in time, and they waited 2,000 feet to stop. Well, it's usually because of marijuana. So I think the gulf has never been greater between what the science knows and what the public's misunderstanding is. I'm not going to dwell on medical marijuana because we're not really talking about that today, but you heard my point of view. Treat it like a medicine. Do the research. There are medical components within it. Big deal. There are medical components within the opium plant. Good. We synthesize the opium plant into morphine. We have a defined dose. And if we didn't, you know, with all the opiate problems in this country, if we did not have morphine, we'd have a public health disaster due to a pain. You can't say we're going to eliminate morphine. But we would never tell someone to smoke opium. Can you imagine if we said that? You know what? Forget about the morphine or anything in the hospital. We're going to give you a cigarette of opium and want you to smoke opium or a gummy bear of opium. And because if you don't like to smoke. And you can't go to a doctor because they're not allowed to do it. Can't go to a pharmacy. We're going to set it up in some other things, or we're going to try and set it up in a pharmacy, but really if a pharmacy dispenses it, it's actually federally illegal what they're doing. And we don't know the dosage. We're not really sure about the side effects because we're not, you know, the amount of plant in here is, we don't know if there's a twig or there's an extra flower or seed, but, you know, this is the plant material. But, you know, go ahead, use this and to let us know how it goes. No, we would never do that. So why can't we have an adult conversation about this issue? Get what's medical and get over it. Use it in the pharmacy and that's it for those who really need it. Now, those who say, well, I happen to have a headache today and, you know, my back kind of hurts and I need to go down to Venice Beach because the bikini girl there is going to give me my marijuana. It's obvious what then this is about. But if it's really about the kids that have the seizures, you know, we don't want to be giving parents of kids that have seizures something that they have no idea what's in it. The FDA just, which was very rare for them, I mean, after 20 years of this whole issue, the FDA just issued 20 warning letters to these CBD companies because they were selling something that, you know, oil looks like this, sometimes it's clear. And they tested these, and they had contaminants, they had pesticides, they had THC. This is the reason a lot of these kids were not reacting well to this. That's not the right way to do it. And I'm not saying the FDA is always right. Clearly they're not. But frankly, I'd rather have an FDA than not. I don't want to have snake oil being sold to cure baldness or worse. We need a regulatory body. States are not equipped to be the regulatory body. We need science to be leading on this issue. But see, it's in the interest of the advocates to mix these issues up, to bring the person down in a wheelchair and say, Governor, are you really going to say no to these poor kids? And it's not only no to these poor kids. You need to legalize marijuana, all of it, because we're not sure which one worked for them or whatever. So really, this is, and they do that. And who's going to vote against the kid or the cancer patient, right, in suffering? It doesn't allow us to have the debate that we need to have. This idea that countless people are behind bars for smoking marijuana. I'm the first one to say we need criminal justice reform in this country. We have 5 times as many people in prison than our historical average. We also have 5 times as many than any European country on the average, okay? I get that we're maybe a more violent country than those countries, and you look at the rates of violent crime, and they're much higher here, but the idea that we can't have criminal justice reform without legalizing marijuana makes absolutely no sense at all. First of all, people are not in prison for smoking marijuana. When you look at who's actually in prison, marijuana-only possession is minuscule. And it's usually because they have something else going on. But further than this, folks, I think it's frankly, it's an affront to the whole issue of civil rights and criminal justice reform to say, if only we legalized marijuana, that would solve the problems in our criminal justice system. Well, guess what? Yesterday, the report came out of Colorado and Washington. Guess what's happening with African-American and Latino arrest rates since legalization? They've gone up, not down. The disproportionate, still there. The ratio, still there. And so this is probably an issue about all crimes that is much larger than the issue of even drugs or even marijuana. And my worry, frankly, is that the other report that came out of Colorado is that there are more marijuana stores in poorer communities than in upper. Now, is that any different here with alcohol? Or are you guys, you have it all equitable? Yeah, that's what I thought. But I have a feeling there are, by population, more in the inner city of Hartford than, you know, Fairfield or something, or, you know, Westport. I have a feeling that Greenwich. I have a feeling that there are more disproportionate alcohol outlets in those communities. And that's not a surprise, folks. When you're in an industry like this and you need addicts, it's the whole point of the industry. You need addicts. You don't make money without addicts. Remember that. Okay? When you need addicts, you want to go to the places that have more likelihood of someone not having the backup to get them out of that addiction. You want to go somewhere where the housing, the healthcare delivery, the education, the income is lower. And so that's why when I see celebrities or I see Real Time with Bill Maher, you know, if you watch that, and Bill Maher talks about, he loves to talk about his pot use, okay? It's like, he makes $20 million a year. If something goes wrong with his marijuana use, he can go to Malibu treatment centers for $100,000 a month, and he'll probably be just fine. But the issue is, when you don't have those resources, these addictive companies know it. Do you know where OxyContin first appeared? Purdue Pharma brought it. Where did they bring it to? They brought it to the poorest areas of Appalachia. In those cases, rural white communities with no money. Okay? They brought it to those communities who had paid, because they were mining communities, because they knew that they were going to be getting, frankly, more bang for their buck than going through the fancy schmancy doctor's offices and other places. Now, of course, it's spread. But that's where you go first. You know, the tobacco executives, do you know what they once said when they were asked if they smoked? I mean, they blatantly had this in their records. They said, we don't smoke this. Are you kidding me? This is like in the 60s when they were saying it's safe. We don't smoke it. We reserve that right for the young, the poor, the black, and the stupid. But they said that openly. So we got to really, if we want to talk about social justice, which we will be talking about later, let's think about what the impact of this dropout drug is. Right, on communities that don't need more structural inequality, which is absolutely what this kind of thing, legalization brings. It doesn't mean that we want to say that there aren't problems. I don't think they should get an arrest record. You know, when you're 16 years old and you make a mistake, you shouldn't be able to get away with that just if you're rich and if you have a lawyer that you can hire to get you out of that. No. We need to make sure that you don't get, you know, that you have a second chance, and talk about that today. There are diversion programs, and by the way, let's see if there's a problem and treat that problem. You know, if you're getting arrested 10 times for public use and you're 15, well, maybe there's an issue. Let's see what's going on with that rather than promote that. And then finally, this legality of alcohol and tobacco strengthen the case for legal marijuana. Folks, alcohol and tobacco are the last things we ever would want to model public health policy on. You know, alcohol is legal because of its cultural acceptance in society. 70% of the West has used it for hundreds of years. It's been in our society for millennia. Yes, marijuana has been in our society for a long time, folks, but guess what? It's been used by less than 10%. Never more than 10% of the West. That's so different than something used on a regular basis. So I say that because we're kind of stuck with it, but we're stuck with it at our peril. Can you imagine teachers saying, like, if only more people drank, we'd be more, forget about the kids, if only more parents drank regularly, we'd all be better off. Or cops, can you imagine cops saying that? If only more of the people that were drunk, it would make our life easier. No, alcohol's not legal because it's a wild public health success. It actually costs us something like $200 billion a year in lost social costs. It's legal for cultural reasons. The idea that we'd want to do that again with an intoxicant like marijuana makes absolutely no sense. And this is what I was talking about with the heavy use of the drug. 10% of us drink 75% of the alcohol in this country. So the majority of us don't do that, but the small amount of us do. That is where the revenues and the profits come from. You have to promote this kind of heavy use. There's a reason why alcohol taxes are a fifth of what they were than during the Korean War. Folks, when it's legal and commercialized, you have special interest lobbies, and they want to make sure it's as cheap as possible. By the way, when I say Korean War to students, they don't even, they have to Google it, because they don't know what that is. It's 1950s. It's 80% less than it was when you control for inflation. It's one of the only commodities where taxes have gone down. Well, it's because there are organized industries around it. These things become cheap, and when they become cheap, guess what? They're used more. This is the whole point of certain liquor products, and especially the pricing that goes on, especially in the inner city. The discounts, couponing that goes on in the inner cities, that's on purpose. Because when it's cheaper, more people will use it. And the industry knows that. And by the way, this idea that cartels are going to go away if only we legalize marijuana. Folks, cartels are not cartels. They're transnational criminal organizations. Their number one source of revenue is not drugs. It's people, human trafficking, and immigration, kidnapping and extortion, cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine, and finally, last, marijuana. The idea that they're going to somehow magically go away if only we would legalize makes absolutely no sense at all. And I'm not going to dwell on that point, but in Colorado, let me tell you, it's never been a better time to be a drug dealer. Do you know any drug dealers? Tell them to go to Colorado. Because there are three markets now in Colorado. There's the illegal market, there's the gray market, and there's the legal market. And why is there an illegal market? Well, guess what? A lot of people don't want to pay 30% tax. They're happy to go to the person they've been going to forever. They want marijuana at midnight, at 1 a.m. Where are they going to go? And by the way, oh, they happen to be under 21. They don't have a fake ID. So they go to the gray market. The older brother gets it or whatever. And so now you have three markets there because the demand has soared so much. Folks, my issue with this whole thing and what I worry about, I don't worry about, you know, I went to Berkeley undergrad in California, so I know the whole hippie movement and all that. And let me tell you, you know, they're great people. That's cool. That's wonderful for them. I don't worry about the hippies from the 60s. This is not the, you know, the Woodstock folks that I worry about. Frankly, and I also don't, you know, in this issue, it's not even about, you know, the Mexican drug lords, because we always like to blame our problems on other countries. You can't in this case, because marijuana of today, the majority of it is made in the USA marijuana, because it's so high potent. My worry is not those guys. My worry is are guys like this. You know, the guys that I went to grad school with, Yale MBAs. One of them is Yale. I never get to say that in Connecticut, so it's interesting, because I say this a lot. But these are the Ivy League MBA and lawyers. That's who's driving this whole thing. They don't use marijuana. They have to get to their meetings on time, and they're not. But they want other people to use it, and they want other people to use a lot of it. And they really want you to use a lot of it if you live in a community where you may not have the access to healthcare, housing, and education as the other communities. That's what they really want. And so, this is what is so scary about this, frankly, is that it is not the, you know, hippies. It's not Cheech and Chong anymore. And by the way, when I say Cheech and Chong, also it's the 16-year-old, they don't know who that is. If they watch Dancing with the Stars, they know one of them. That's it. Okay? But this is who I'm. These are button-up, nice guys, like the guys that you want to marry, you know, your daughters to marry. They're not the people that you're like, oh my God, they're the scary drug dealer with the trench coat in the corner, or they're the gangster we don't want, or they're the, you know, hippie that hasn't showered. No. They are the people who look great, and they are convincing legislators, governors, and people with money that they can get in on this too. This is what we have to alert people to. Do we want to go through the nightmare of the last 100 years that we did with tobacco, the last 20 with pharma, last God knows how long with alcohol? This is our question. We were duped for 100 years by a tobacco industry that said tobacco's not addictive and we're pretty sure it doesn't cause lung cancer. Do you know, by the way, when we found out tobacco caused lung cancer? Do you know when that was? Guess the decade. 50s,
60s.
Well, 60s is the and 50s is an educated guess, because the Surgeon General came out with a report, right, in 1964, saying marijuana causes, I mean, tobacco causes lung cancer. So try the 1920s, the first published research. And it was hidden for so long, and our government finally came around to it 40 years later and said something. Do you know when the tobacco industry admitted that, by the way? Because they denied that for 30, well, I just gave it away. Even in the mid-1990s, they were saying, we're not, no, in our opinion, it's, and we have the videos. If you go to our website, which we'll show you at the end, we have the video on C-SPAN. You can even look it up on C-SPAN, of the tobacco executives lined up right there in 1994 saying tobacco's not addictive. So the question, and we believed it. It's called, how do we believe it? It's called tobacco vending machines. It's called Joe Camel. It's called cartoons that we had of, it's called candy cigarettes. We believed it for 100 years. And the question is, are we gonna believe this? And they wanna say, well, no, this is reefer madness. This is gonna be, you know. We're not saying that this is reefer madness. We're saying the risk goes up. Today's pot is stronger than it used to be. And we don't need more of these kinds of industries promoting their items in our communities. They just bought the name Bob Marley for $50 million from his widow. These guys did. And they now have Marley Natural, as they like to use the word natural, in their first brand of pre-rolled cigarettes. The marketing comes out of Manhattan, actually. The production is in the Northwest. This is what they're trying to do. And I just want people to remember our history. I mean, folks, 100 years ago, we were talking about asthma cigarettes. Medical tobacco. That's how tobacco was introduced. Then we gave it away for free during the war, World War I, to lighten the load of military work, lighten the load of war. And then we, in the 50s, we said, well, it's not really, you know, this says, by the way, this says for your health, asthma cigarettes. Dr. Batty's asthma cigarettes. Now, no, asthma, hay fever, foul breath. No, but isn't tobacco can cure foul breath? All diseases of the throat, head colds, cancer, sores, bronchial irritations. This is no different from what we're going through right now. And we're being blinded by the, oh my God, this is the cure-all for everything. And by the way, it's even the cure-all for our budget woes. We're going to get money. And then 50 years later, they had these kinds of ads. No, more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette, et cetera, et cetera. And unfortunately, young people today, high schoolers, many of them college students, they don't know what this is. They don't know who Joe Camel is. They don't know what big tobacco is. They were born after that. They didn't have vending machines. They didn't have a smoking patio for juniors and seniors in high school. Don't date yourself by laughing at that, nodding. Yes, no, they weren't that long ago. But they don't know what that is. They've grown up in a society where we stigmatize tobacco. I mean, you can't smoke. I don't think you can't even smoke in your car, because if you ever want to sell it, no one will buy it, including fellow smokers. You certainly can't smoke in your own house. If you live with a non-smoker, you'll be kicked out in a second. So unless you're going to live a life alone somewhere that, you know, you never want to sell again, even smoking in private's hard these days. We have totally pushed it out. We haven't necessarily stigmatized the users. We want to get them treatment. There are fewer users. But with marijuana, we've gone to the exact opposite way. We've said, well, that's terrible, but this actually is okay. And by the way, the tobacco industry, they've already written about the pot industry. Do we think that they're going to be sitting out on this one? Folks, it's a plant that you manufacture and process and roll into a cigarette. It's the exact same thing. They've already talked about how they want to get into this business. I don't have time to go through all the smoking. These are the confidential drafts I was talking about earlier of the quotes from the tobacco industry and about how we were fooled. We forget about this as Americans. We forget about it and we just think that it never happened, and then we get fooled again. The budgetary issue, which we'll talk about more. Bottom line, first of all, guess what drug is responsible for more arrests than any other drug in this country? Right, alcohol. That's legal. There are more people in the criminal justice system today for public drunkenness, DUI, and selling to minors than for all drugs combined. So not exactly the thing. And as I said earlier, in Colorado, we've seen an increase. marijuana, even the New York Times has said marijuana taxes will not save state budgets. It's their promise, the new schools. There's no new schools. They're promised the new playgrounds, the new this, the new that, the infrastructure. If you're the average person in Denver and you don't really care about this issue and you don't use marijuana, but you hear that it could fund your school, you're like, well, okay, I guess so. Would you try it? This is why these are passing, because the average person who does not use marijuana has bought into this argument that it's going to produce tax revenue. And again, alcohol and tobacco, we don't make any money from these guys. I don't know how we're going to make money from marijuana. Finally, the last thing that we're told, and I don't have a lot of time to go through it, though, but that prevention, intervention, and treatment don't work, so why even try? You know, that is like saying anything that we do doesn't work. You know, talking about safe sex doesn't work because there's still people that have unsafe sex. Talking about, you know, prevention in any of the health domains don't work because people still do it. Well, no. You lower the amount of the use, and that is what's happening. Very briefly, Colorado and Washington. Folks, welcome to marijuana in Colorado and Washington. This is what legal marijuana looks like. It's not a joint that you pass around. It is these products that make the majority of the market in Colorado. And they target young people because that is going to be who your future customer is. And let me tell you, this is an industry that during the campaign, and they will say this here too, they've done it every state, they say, no, we're not going to allow that. We're going to regulate it in a very specific, restrictive way. The minute it gets in, all bets are off. You can't restrict advertising as long as you have a First Amendment. Good luck restricting these kinds of products when the people who are actually at the table setting the rules are the industry. And they insist to be at the table. You can't even have a conference in Colorado to talk about the harms of marijuana without the industry either showing up en masse or protesting the whole thing and saying, we're not getting our equal time. Well, you know what, I'm sorry. When we talk about tobacco education, we don't invite Philip Morris to give a talk. When we talk about the opiate crisis, we don't have Purdue Pharma stand up and give a 30-minute infomercial about how wonderful the things that they're doing. So I don't know why this is any different, but for some reason in these states, well, the reason is, when you legalize it, you legitimize it. And that's exactly what's happening with all of these products. And, you know, the advertisements, the billboard. Folks, free dab is what this billboard says. The dab is that 98% THC I was talking about. I think there's actually an article, because it was online yesterday, so I'm guessing it's in today's print edition of the New York Times, about, if anybody saw it, about dabbing here in this area. It used to be a West Coast phenomenon. Well, you know, the internet knows no boundaries. Figure out how to do this. And that's why when people say it's a state's rights issue, have you heard of the internet? I mean, things travel. You know, attitudes and behaviors travel over state borders. It doesn't make any sense. That's why we have federal laws on a lot of things, including a lot of things like drugs. All the coupons and the advertisements, these are for, you know, the vape issues, the e-cigarettes, because let me tell you, if you're an eighth grade teacher and you think you're going to smell the pot coming out of the boys' bathroom like you used to, you're not. Because now it's in a pen, it's in a highlighter, it's in something that looks like this, it's in a flash drive, and it doesn't smell. And it's used in plain view. All of these things. They weren't allowed to have cartoons. Well, guess what? They do. There's something called biomarketing. You market for the audience based on basically the audience's brains. And when the audience have young brains, that's why you use cartoons. That's why, you know, you don't write things for little kids in Times 8 Roman font. Well, there are reasons these things occur. We don't think about it, but there are reasons. That's why when we're, most of us, I should say, are switching channels and there's a cartoon, we may not stop at that cartoon. We'd be less likely, I think, to stop at the cartoon than something else. Well, it's because we don't identify with that as much, but the kids do. It's opposite. So they weren't allowed to have, but they do. All of these kinds of things of the way they are marketing this high-end, more low-end, et cetera. Just wanted to give you a little snapshot of what's happening. So there have been deaths. There have been all kinds of things which we're not going to get into. People say, deaths? What do you mean deaths? You can't overdose from marijuana because you don't have the receptors, thankfully, in the brainstem that'll, you know, that the reason you overdose on opiates, by the way, you have the receptors in the brainstem that control the breathing. That's the reason, the scientific reason. You don't have those. Cannabinoids aren't in the brainstem. So you don't have the fatal overdose. You can overdose. Many people do. They don't have fatal overdose. But people are dying. People are falling off of balconies and buildings. You heard also in Washington State a few days ago, a Muslim teenager, and I say Muslim because they thought it was a hate crime. They thought he was pushed off of the balcony, a hate crime. They just did the 1 month investigation. They found out he was with his best friend. It had nothing to do with a hate crime. It was he used high potency marijuana, had a panic attack because he didn't like what he did and he felt sorry and bad about it. He didn't feel good, felt terrible, went outside, fell off the balcony and died. Now, you know, we're in touch with the family. Talk to that family and tell them that marijuana doesn't kill. It's never killed anybody. This is happening now on a regular basis. It happened in Denver with a kid from Africa who was visiting Wyoming and then came to Colorado. And so marijuana use, surprise, surprise, is increasing in Colorado and Washington faster than anywhere else in the country. In Colorado, young people, 12 to 17, marijuana use is now number one in the country. Number one, it never used to be. And they're trying to say, no, it's not, it's going down, we're not sure, it's significantly not going up. No, they're trying to couch it in every way they can. But this is the reality of it. I will leave all this data with you, but things like drugs driving, we already talked about. On the job marijuana use, if you're a business, good luck over there. They're now hiring from out of state because they can't get people to pass a drug test. You know, this happened in Appalachia, when I was talking about Appalachia earlier. In 2009, the Great Recession, nobody could get a job, okay? In Appalachia, they were begging people to apply for the jobs that they had there. They couldn't get anybody, and this is when the mining industry was not, you know, it was still much more prosperous than it is today. They were hiring. They couldn't get people to pass a drug test because they had opiates in their system when OxyContin was big there. It's during the recession they couldn't get people. They were begging. We're seeing the same thing happening in many parts of Colorado and Washington. The largest construction company now for the first time goes outside of the state to hire, because of the increase that they have seen. They don't want to take the risk. You know, somebody does something at work, there's an accident, well, they're going to say, well, it was in my system I used it on Friday legally at night. Today's Monday. You don't know if I was fine. This is the nightmare that's happening with these lawsuits that are all starting. And another thing is, if you're a lawyer, it's a good time to go to Colorado too, because there's a lot of lawsuits about all these issues now as well. The drug, and also if you're in the drug testing cheating business, it's a good time to go. This is a huge issue in the workplace. The pro-marijuana lobby is spending millions and millions and millions of dollars on their initiatives. They did it in 2014 in Alaska and Oregon, because people are like, well, Kevin, why are these things passing all of a sudden? It's not because they're only 10 to 15% of people in these states are using marijuana. It can't be because they just want to smoke pot. What's the real reason? Well, they're being duped into these arguments funded by a lobby. I will say, though, what's interesting is that the majority of municipalities in Colorado have banned the sales of marijuana in their community. Because when it goes from theory to practice, things change. You know, in theory, it's like, well, it sounds good, we can get revenue, what's the big deal, it's safer than alcohol. And then it's like, okay, well, we're going to open one in your community next to, you know, the place next to the art gallery you go to with your kids on the weekends, next to the ice cream store, next to the church, within 1,000 feet of school. And people are like, no, no, we don't want this. And they banned them. So there's been this whole move, actually, to ban them outright. What is the industry doing here in Connecticut? Well, a couple of things. First of all, the groups, Marijuana Policy Project, the National Organization for Reform Marijuana Laws, Drug Policy Alliance, they're spending money here. They really see New England, because they don't want to make this a West Coast only thing. That has an image problem. If it's only like the West Coast doing this, is kind of like a weird issue. This is about making it mainstream. So New England is a natural target because they won't win anytime soon in the South. So New England, they feel like with these arguments, more intelligent arguments, they can win the populace over. So they are trying to do things here in Connecticut, which we'll talk about later today. This is why one of the reasons why we're here today. And by the way, people say, well, how could they do that with federal law? True. Federal law makes marijuana illegal. It is illegal. There was a memo by this Justice Department a few years ago saying, it's illegal, we can prosecute you at any time, but right now we're not going to. So as long as you do a couple of things and you don't increase use, yeah, we're going to forget about it. Well, they are increasing use. There are problems. The Congress, in many ways, is up in arms because there's no enforcement of what's happening. And it's we're really in legal limbo. We have a federal law, but it's not being enforced. It does mean that if there is a different president or attorney general, things can change at any time. State employees could be arrested for carrying out federal law, things contrary to federal law. I don't think that'll go to that extreme. But they have been threatened before in letters in Washington State a couple of years ago. In this administration, actually, they were threatened with that earlier in 2010. So, you know, it's a moving, we'll see, but there is no appetite in Congress to change federal law. And people say, well, it's going to change, it's inevitable, it's going to change, but it's not. There's really no appetite to change that. And this tide of money has resulted in legalization over really a huge portion of the country. And so right now, they're looking at California, Nevada, Arizona, Massachusetts, and Maine. They tried this year, in late last year in Ohio, and this year in Vermont and Rhode Island. And Vermont, we have very good news coming out of Vermont. Because I understand this is going to be a very depressing talk I give. I mean, people leave and they're like, oh my God, well, I thought it was bad, but boy, it's really bad. We're never going to defeat this industry. It's this gargantuan, you know, behemoth. How could we ever? Actually, we can. And we have. That's the awesome news. In Vermont, a group like this basically got together about a year before. Sort of things got hot there, and knew that this was coming, and said we are going to be ready to. We're not. We don't have the millions of dollars. We don't have. They have a professional lobbyist. The pros. We may not have that, but we are going to write our legislators, talk about this now in our communities. You know, make radio advertisements on the cheap that can therefore be played in certain markets at certain times. Do social media. To have infographics, get people together, different communities, different demographics, to speak about this issue to their representative and resist what's happening. And it was incredible because Vermont was a slam dunk for the legalizers. 6 months ago even, 3 months ago even, they said they were going to do this. The governor, first sitting governor in the country to be in favor of legalization. He's the outgoing governor, he's leaving this year, Peter Shumlin. And who, by the way, had shown so much, you know, leadership on the heroin opiate issue, and then turns around and says, we need to regulate marijuana. And so they had the governor against them, and they had the Senate against them, because the governor used to serve in the Senate. It's all his buddies. And it sailed through the Senate. The governor was pushing it, pushing it a lot harder than, I mean, even when, you know, he says he was in favor, people thought, well, he's not going to, why would he revisit this? What? He kept revisiting it. I don't know if he has a nice job waiting for him after. I don't know what's happening there. But he just kept revisiting it. And basically, there was a movement there, and the SAM group there got together and defeated it in the House by a lot. And even the more modest reforms that, you know, I was ready to say, well, we should compromise. I mean, if we need to compromise, it's better than having regulated stores. If you want to have a commission or do something else, you know, as a fallback, okay, those didn't even pass. I mean, it just was such a change in the House. And it happened because of just basically a group of people like is here today came together and said, we're going to get together and stop this. Now, I'm gonna go forward here. Concluding thoughts. I do want to leave you with just a couple of things. I call them barbecue questions because they're just questions to bring up to family and friends and other people. You know, it's hard to talk about this study or that study. There's always somebody refuting it. But at the end of the day, we got to think about what kind of community and state and family and neighborhood we want. Are your relationships better off when people are smoking pot all the time? I mean, that's just a question that we all can answer. Does this make for better neighbors, better parents, more prosperous communities and schools? How is this helping where we want to go as a community, lifting communities up? How is this helping where we want to go as a state? And of course, it doesn't help. And I think when it's framed like that versus, is it safer than alcohol or can we get money? Those are deliberately framed for us to get into these tangled conversations and conclude with basically nothing. And then legalization comes in. We have to reframe the issue. And we absolutely, you know, when I'm in an elevator and someone says, what do you do? Or I'm on a plane and, you know, we can talk about that. I can talk, as you could, shocking to you, I could speak for hours about this, I know. But, I essentially say to people, strangers, I say, well, we're trying to stop the next big tobacco. I mean, it's like, what? I mean, people are stunned when you say that. They're like, what next big tobacco? What are you talking about? You know, and it's like, well, you know, there's a movement to legalize marijuana, and they're doing it for money. And people are like, you know, I never thought of it that way, but yeah, they are. See, people are, well, I always thought of it as it's safer than alcohol, we could regulate it. Because that's, of course, the rhetoric that's been out there for the last 20 years. Millions of, I haven't talked about on the national movement who's funding this. It's basically three billionaires. Two of whom are dead now, but their estate funding this. The other one's in his mid to late 80s. Anyhow, it's you know, it has permeated. But when we reframe the issue to, we just don't think it's prosperous, it's going to help our communities if more people are using weed every day. People are like, yeah, that doesn't make sense. They may not want to see people go to prison. Of course not. We don't either. So we talk about that as well. But I think reframing this is very, very important. So the basic takeaways: marijuana is harmful and addictive. Legalizing marijuana will not prevent young people in urban areas from being incarcerated for offenses. It will not eliminate the underground market. It will not bring revenue for the state to fix our deficit. Folks, we're going to be spending money. Guess how much money you have to spend if you start to regulate marijuana? Well, you got to hire a lot of people because you're not regulating it. And that costs money. It doesn't fix budget deficits at all. And so today, we're excited to do this kickoff of Stop Pot. That's signed in person, but right up here. We want to build a grassroots local and statewide coalition to strategize, to align policies and oppose marijuana here in Connecticut. And that's why we're here today. This is important because we have to raise awareness. This is important because it's crucial. Our objectives here are to develop effective strategies to provide oversight to people that can get involved easily. Because it can feel overwhelmed. It can feel like, oh my God, we're against this industry, and I don't know, I'm not a great speaker, or you need speakers, or I don't know, I'm not the best writer. I don't know which arguments to use. That's why we're coming together. We're going to provide toolkits. We're going to provide advice and strategy. But we need each of you in your own way, family, legislator, whatever, to be talking about this issue and create the buzz around the state, because they are coming to Connecticut. You know, Vermont, Rhode Island, Connecticut, Massachusetts, these are the states that they're targeting. And we have to work together. We're going to have breakouts, the two breakouts. First is not just a little lead, the reality of today's marijuana. We're going to go into more detail. You know, it's important, rather than give you 5,000 talking points to remember throughout the day, we want to keep repeating themes so that they are with you, that you can go and repeat them, you can use them. Social justice issue and legalization, I'm looking forward to that breakout as well to discuss what's happening with decriminalization. I'm very curious. You've had decriminalization. Okay, because they say we need to decriminalize marijuana and therefore sell it in stores in Connecticut. Wait a minute. You've had it before. You've already had it. And I actually think that word decriminalization is very confusing. I mean, it's the word we have. We're sort of stuck with it. But especially the media, I think, often interchangeably uses it with legalization. And people are like, I think we should legalize because people shouldn't go to prison. Okay, well, did you decriminalize? Well, yeah, okay, that's what I meant. I mean, so it's a confusing topic. It's important to unpack that. I did want to leave the website with you, SAM website, which has a lot of resources and information for you. John here, John Davio, is a wonderful resource, and our liaison here, our affiliate in the state. Learnaboutsam.org is the website. Learnaboutsam.org. Tons of talking points. It has the tobacco video I told you about. It has other videos and multimedia presentations as well. So I know because I'm right on time, I'm going to pretend that I'm like a minute early. So do we want to take, if there are any questions,
yes,
for 2 or 3 minutes,
yes,
we have time for that? Okay, great. So, yes.
I was wondering your thoughts on, did Portugal legalize all drugs?
Good question. So the question was about Portugal and what Europe has done. So nowhere has legalized all drugs in the world. Nowhere has done that, including Portugal. What Portugal did is they basically created another system for drug possession of small amounts for all drugs. Another system meaning not criminal or civil. And we don't have the equivalent here. It's not even really administrative. But basically, if you get caught with a tiny amount of any drug, you go to a panel of three people in Portugal who say you should get treatment, you should pay a fine, community service, we're going to give you a warning. It's a different system in that way. What has happened in Portugal? The first thing that's happened is that everyone thinks that it's legalized drugs. it's a total misperception out there what they've done. The second thing that's happened, they've had mixed reviews on what has happened because they've also included, at the same time they did that, they doubled their investment in treatment. So the other thing, like more people are going to treatment since that, which is great. Is it because of that policy? I don't know. There have been a slight increase in youth drug use, depending on which measure you use. Is that because of that, or was that going to go up anyway? Very hard to know. But in Portugal, It's a very different system. It's not anything regarding legalization, and they get very upset in international forums when people are like, Portugal legalized, we should treat it like Portugal. And they're like, no, we didn't. It's almost like a drug court system in a way. I mean, you sort of have a body that assesses, like an assessment, and then decides what should happen. Yeah.
Hi.
You mentioned that in Colorado, the arrests for minority have increased.
Yeah.
And seeing marijuana is legal, what are the arrests? What are they getting arrested for?
Great. So oftentimes, well, there are legal doesn't mean no rules at all. I mean, technically, you're supposed to have some rules around it. So they're seeing a lot of this has gone on in schools with young people, like arrests at schools for young people. It's not legal. Not legal if you're under 21. So a lot of it is youth, which I don't think is a good thing. A lot of it is public use and driving as well. So it's the same kind of things, like alcohol is legal, but we still arrest more people for alcohol than any drug. It's a very similar thing like that. But in Colorado and Washington, a lot of it is young people on school premises, which is obviously a huge issue. They think it's legal for them or it's not a big deal. And you see that. Yes?
I'm Dr. Ifra Cameron from the Newport Health Center. I have about a dozen things to talk about, but I mentioned only two or three, hopefully the rest I can talk with you. Number one danger, actually, in North America, in a year or two, marijuana going to be legalized in Canada.
Yeah.
It's not a speculation. Mm-hmm. It's a clear fact. The Canadian Addiction and Mental Health Center, which is one of the best in the world, wrote a very favorable paper on regulation. We need to take it into consideration. Second quick piece of news for you. I'm on the advisory board of a new research society for marijuana. It's a new organization, national, we become international. We already got 300 members. And the focus will be on research of marijuana. So hopefully there will be a steady stream of reliable information. The third issue is, you haven't mentioned anything about medical marijuana, so I don't know if you gave up the fight. But one point I'd like to make, Minnesota is the only state that medical marijuana is non-smokable. I'd like to use it as a leverage
in New York
to convince other states that medicine is not smokable. The question is, are you guys going to do anything?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I thought I mentioned a little bit on medical, but we didn't want to dwell on it too much today. But absolutely, look, medicine should be done not by the ballot box or legislature, in my mind. When it is, though, for example, New York State also is not smokable. And so, obviously, I'd rather see New York or the Minnesota model over California or, you know, Colorado. I still think the answer to the medical is not having states do these little things here one by one. It's having, like you mentioned, the federal research. And if you go to our website, we have a 6-point plan for Congress to do the research on marijuana's medical components. And we're actually pushing, in fact, maybe very soon, going to support a federal bill, a very specific bill on how to do the research. Because a lot of people think you should reschedule marijuana. They say, well, if you reschedule to Schedule 2, you can do the research. Actually, that's not the main issue. Cocaine is a Schedule 2 drug. It's very restrictive. Scheduling is so confusing for folks. And people talk about it as if it means legal penalties. Scheduling has nothing to do with legal penalties at all. Again, cocaine is a Schedule 2 drug. We treat cocaine a lot worse than we do marijuana in terms of arrest and things like that. So the answer is not scheduling, even though that's a nice bumper sticker. Reschedule, no. The answer is there are some 6 or 7 very specific things Congress can do, and also the FDA and DEA could do today without even asking Congress to increase the research and to get the components, make sure it's not smoked. For me, that's the best route, rather than promoting even what New York and Minnesota has done. But as a fallback, absolutely, I think New York and Minnesota, those models are better than the other states. But by the way, New York is what's happening now. This year in the legislature, they're saying, you know, I know we said that we were okay with a non-smoked and keeping it very small, but we kind of changed our mind now. We want to have it bigger. A lot of people do want to smoke it. You know, they want the edibles. They want the other things as well. So we really think we should lower the age, and it should be for, you know, any kind of pain and headaches. So the problem is, even that's not my first strategy, because I know that even when you do have a more responsible law, they will try and open it. In a state like Minnesota, maybe you have sensible Minnesotans where that won't happen. I live in New York now, though, so I can say. But in New York, things can, I think, be a little bit more chaotic, so to speak. And I worry about the special interests, especially from Wall Street, by the way, who are coming in and trying to invest in this, because they won't make money if it's a small program. If it's 100 people on your program with stage 4 cancer that simply want the THC and Marinol doesn't work for them, and they want these other products, that's one thing. But they're not going to make money from that. So.
So I have not given up the fight on that. I think we should not legislate marijuana by fiat and whatever people think is what it should be. It should be the science, neuropractical. Yes?
You mentioned that most of the marijuana consumed in America today was grown in America and not imported anymore. Where could I go to get statistics on that trend?
I believe we have some on our website, but actually DEA, very easy, you could find DEA said, well, where did this originate from and whatnot. And yes, most of the marijuana, we grow much better marijuana than Mexico. And you know, we're not gonna be getting it from Morocco, and they grow good marijuana too. But we grow the best because we've learned the indoor growing conditions as well. Indoor is you know, you can really sort of calibrate very specifically when you do it indoors. And the outdoor, in California and Kentucky, ripe. They're great places for growing marijuana. And so, in the old days, but 30, 40 years ago, if you wanted strong marijuana, you wanted Mexican marijuana. It was called sin semilla, meaning without seeds. Okay, because the American marijuana, you were literally sorting out twigs from leaves, and I mean, it was a mixture of things. Now that's not the case with American. Yeah, sir.
What are the potential, as a comment maybe take about it, convoluted unintended benefits is the increase of research and treatment as the increase of use? This is a convoluted way of thinking about it. How do you address, or maybe some historical examples of how people was led down the path support something even though they knew it was destructive, but the long range results of the scientific study show some other benefit that was waiting in society, like a cure for X. Mm. And so they're willing to take the risk of going down that path.
I think that question, which is a very good one, the basis of it a little bit confuses research and recreational use. Because we do have an historical example of opium. You know, 100 years ago, we made a very clear distinction when we were researching opium that we were going to have medical uses of components of, by the way, which is a much less complex plant than marijuana, but we were going to have medical components and medical formulations of opium, and then there was a not acceptable recreational use of heroin or opium also, by the way. And we went down that path, we bifurcated it, which I think was very good. Now, have we had problems in pharmaceuticals? Yes, painkillers recently. Obviously, there are problems. But we made that distinction. With marijuana, we didn't make any distinction. I mean, there was some research going on that was kind of ignored, and we only went down the path of a culture war. You know, of like, if you're either using it, meaning you're one of those horrible anti-war and, you know, whatever people, or great and whatever side you're on, and if you're not, you know, you're the establishment. And it became part of this culture war, and so we weren't able to have the kind of research and, you know, the sort of more careful on the potential medical value. I think we need to follow the opium path and say that there are medical parts that we need to look at and proper research, but there are also totally illegitimate uses and medical pretense. People say medical excuse reasons, and we need to separate those two things. And no, we do that with cocaine. Cocaine is used in a very small amount, very limited circumstance in medical procedures. That's why it's a Schedule II drug. But obviously that's different than, you know, using it recreationally. So I think we just have to go and make that distinction. But it's not in the interest of legalization folks to make that distinction, because that doesn't further the agenda. Furthering the agenda is the medical excuse, not in saying, wait a minute, let's be serious about separating this.
Great, we want to thank Kevin.
Thank you.
Give him a round of applause?
Thank you, everybody.
The breakout sessions back up.
Oh, yeah.
As we transition.